Does the situation, all the circumstances of the supplicant, have any bearing on whether or not Allah accepts the dua?
As I mentioned earlier, that the situation or circumstances, and if you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he can supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there are certain situations which are preferable. For example, when a person is fasting, when a person is traveling, when a just ruler, when he supplicates, or a just imam, or a father supplicates for his son or daughter, or a person who has halal earnings and he supplicates, or it can be a person who prays in sujood, as our beloved Prophet Muhammad said. It's mentioned in Sahih Hadith of Tirmidhi in the Book of Supplications, Hadith number 3598. The Prophet said, the prayer of three people is never rejected. Number one is a just ruler or a imam. Number two, a person who's fasting, especially when he breaks his fast. And number three is a traveler. And the similar hadith which I quoted earlier of Al-Bahaki, hadith number 6093, where the Prophet said, the prayer of three people is never rejected. A father when he prays for his child, a fasting person, especially when he breaks his fast, and a traveling person when he prays. So, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, these are the times which are preferred when a person supplicates as compared to others.
Thank you, Dr. Zakir. And now we'll move to the next important point. Why is it that some people, that often when you're speaking to people, they say, oh, my dua hasn't been answered, you know? This is a common statement by the Muslim brothers and sisters you meet around the place. Why is it that certain supplications perhaps are not answered?
There are certain criteria that are required, and many a time the supplication is rejected because, point number one, maybe the earning is haram. What he's eating is haram. Maybe the earnings where he's driving, all his lifestyle, maybe his business is haram. Maybe involved in riba, usury, interest. He may be dealing in a business which involves bribing, maybe dealing in a business which involves lying, cheating, etc. All these things which are related with haram things, that's the reason, it is one of the major reasons my supplication is not answered. Number two, maybe he is oppressing someone else, causing oppression to another human being. Number three, he may not be enjoining what is good and may not be forbidding what is wrong, which is a fard in Islam. And there are some other criteria required for a supplication to be accepted, and that's the reason why most of them are rejected. One is that we should not say that, oh Allah, forgive me if you please, oh Allah, bless me if you please, or oh Allah, grant me sustenance if you please. Because the beloved Prophet Muhammad, he said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 9, in the Book of Tawheed, hadith number 7477, where the Prophet said that do not supplicate, do not pray by saying that, O Allah, forgive me if you wish. O Allah, grant me mercy if you wish. O Allah, give me from your bounties if you wish. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he does what he wills and you cannot command him. So saying such things is totally wrong, which many people do, which is a big mistake. That is the reason supplications are unanswered. Furthermore, people many a time, they give names to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which Allah never mentioned in the Quran, neither the Prophet used any of the Sahih Hadith. They call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with attributes and names which are not given by Allah and His Rasul. That is totally wrong by supplicating. Furthermore, many people when they supplicate, they add on many names and many things. For example, they say that, please forgive my father, my grandfather, my great-grandfather, my mother, my grandmother, my great-grandmother, my uncle, my auntie, keep on, you know, so it becomes a big list. Instead of that, it's preferable to be brief and say that, please forgive my family, or please forgive my relatives, or my brothers and sisters in Islam. That's sufficient. And one of the other mistakes that people make is they normally supplicate very loudly. You know, very loud supplicate. Where Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Araf, chapter 7, verse number 55, that ask to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with humility and privacy. Allah says in the next verse in Surah Araf, chapter 7, verse 56, that call to Allah with fear and longingness. So these are the basic mistakes that people make when they supplicate. And furthermore, many a time when we ask something from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we may follow all the things, but yet Allah subhanahu does not answer our prayers. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 216, that you may dislike a thing which may be good for you, and you may like a thing which may not be good for you. Allah knows and you do not know. There may be a situation where a Muslim may pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give me a motorcycle, a BMW. I want a BMW 1000cc. And Allah does not answer his prayer. Because Allah knows that if Allah gives him a BMW, he may go fast, he may have accident, he may fracture his leg. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by not answering his prayer, is actually answering him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the knower of the unseen, of the future. So you may like a thing which may not be good for you. Allah knows and you do not know.
Well, jazakallah khair. That means the next question is very appropriate. So would you now tell the viewers some authentic du'as which are good for them that they can make in this month of mercy?
There are hundreds of du'as which are authentic. And if you can refer to the book Fortification of a Muslim through the supplications from the Quran and the authentic hadith, it's a book published which has more than 100 du'as. I think 132 to be precise. I'll just mention a couple of them from the Quran and the hadith since your request is that. The most general dua, which is there in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 201, is Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanata wa fil akhirati hasanata wa qina azaban nar. O my Lord, give us the good in this world and the hereafter, and save us from the torment of hellfire. This is the general dua, which is general and the best. There are various other du'as given in the Quran, and the du'as of the Quran are the best because this is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. Allah says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 8, رَبَّنَا لَا تُذِي قُلُوبَنَا بَعْدْ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا وَحَبْ لَنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْوَحَابِ, which means, O Lord, let not our hearts deviate after Thou has guided us, and grant us mercy from Thy bounty, for Thou art the granter of bounties. The other dua which I always make in the starting of any lecture, which is asking for help for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which you can do when you begin any speech or when you're doing something which is very difficult, is the dua which Musa alayhi salam made when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked Musa alayhi salam, then go and give the message to Pharaoh. So it's mentioned in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 25 to 28. Rabbi shrahli sadri wa yassir li amri wahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli, which means, O my Lord, expand my breast for me and make my task easy for me and remove the impediment which is in my speech so that they will understand me. And you know Musa alayhi salam, he was a stammerer. And as many people are aware, that even I, during my childhood, I was a stammerer. And even now I sometimes stammer. So that is the reason I read this dua at the beginning of every talk. So Musa alayhi salam asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove the impediment from his speech. And furthermore, so that they will understand me. And there is a barrier many a time between you and the person to whom you are giving the message. So we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may that barrier be removed. Therefore, before every talk, I supplicate, so that the audience, if there is a barrier between the audience and myself, it is removed. These were just a few du'as from the Quran. There are several authentic du'as even from the hadith. There is a Sahih hadith in Tirmidhi, as well as Sayyid Nibban, where the Prophet said, that anyone who says Subhanallah wa bihamdi, which means glory be to Allah and praise be to Allah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will plant a date tree for the person in paradise. The other hadith which is there mentioned in Sahih Muslim, Book of Fiqh, hadith number 6509, where the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that anyone who says Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, glory be to Allah and praise be to him, if you mention 100 times, there is nothing more excellent for him on the day of judgment, on the day of resurrection. Nothing better than that. Except someone who says similar words or someone who says something better. A similar hadith is mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 8, hadith number 6405, where the beloved Prophet ﷺ said that anyone who says Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, glory be to Allah and praise be to Allah 100 times, his sins will be forgiven. Even if his sins are equal to the foam of the sea. And there are various authentic hadith. It also says in Sahih Muslim, hadith number 749, that when you hear the call of the Muaddin, then you have to pray and say that I testify that there is no one worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he has got no partners, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the slave and messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I'm pleased with my Lord, who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I'm pleased with my messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I'm pleased with my deen Islam. Anyone who says this, his sin will be forgiven. There are various such hadith. For example, after the Salah obligatory prayers, we say Subhanallah, we say Alhamdulillah, we say Allahu Akbar. If you say 100 times, then your sins will be forgiven. There are other hadith, like after the obligatory prayers, we say Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam, tabakta zalil wal ikram. And in traveling, when we board any vehicle, any plane, any car, etc., dua which our Prophet has said, that Subhanallazi sakhalana haza wa ma kunna lahu mukrinin wa inna ila rabbina munqalibun. So these were just a few samples of the authentic duas from the Quran and the Sahih.